Yo, welcome to our African American History Month episode. I mean, things have gotten so bad that of what's happening in Gaza, colonialists are getting very brave and they're making clips like this.
Millions of people have left Venezuela. I understand why they want to, because they don't want to live under a socialist dictatorship hell. And yes, it's easy for them to mix in lots of truly bad terrorist actors in that deluge of people running from bad governance. Look, all this talk of illegal migration in Europe, in the United States, it ultimately comes down to a contest of what is governance. Who is governed, which countries are governed well? And if so many of these countries around the world are incapable of governing themselves, then it's time for us to just put the imperial hat back on to say, we're going to govern those countries if you're incapable of governing yourselves, because enough is enough. We're done being invaded.
What the fuck are you talking about?
Because our own national security risk is at stake.
Exactly.
National security interests are at stake.
You can say that about pretty much all of Africa. They're incapable of governing themselves and benefiting their citizens, because the governments there are all about looting and pillaging and lining their pockets and going shopping in Paris.
What the fuck are you talking about?
Instead of actually
all right, hold
making
on a
their
second.
Country
hold
a
on.
Better
People on the
land.
Left are going to watch this. They're going to say, wait a minute, Eric Prince is talking about being a colonialist again.
Absolutely. Yes. Enough. Because if you go to these countries and you see how they suffer under absolutely corrupt, made-up governments that are just criminal syndicates, the people of Africa, the people of Latin America, a lot of them deserve better.
Jesus, he's a psychopath. That's a kill order.
What you just heard coming out of that guy's mouth, that is called warmongering. And the only people that tend to benefit from that are privatized companies and non-governmental organizations. That could be the World Economic Forum.
We will see definitely a lot of anger already now, but probably increase by the end of the year, because this crisis will be with us until we really have found a remedy. So we have to prepare for a more angry world.
That could also be what they would call PMCs, private military contractors, or that can also be weapons manufacturers, such as Raytheon, Boeing, Lockheed and Martin, who's made a ton of money anytime there's a war taking place, whether that's with Russia and Ukraine or whether that's all throughout the Middle East. And as Julian Assange likes to put it,
this year marks 10 years of the war in Afghanistan, because the goal is not to completely subjugate Afghanistan. The goal is to use Afghanistan to wash money out of the tax bases of the United States, out of the tax bases of European countries, through Afghanistan and back into the hands of a transnational security elite. That is the goal. I.e. the goal is to have an endless war, not a successful war.
Over the weekend, President Biden said he's ready to take action if Congress is serious about solving the border issue.
If that bill were the law today, I'd shut down the border right now and fix it quickly. And Congress needs to get it done.
Starting another war. still trying to kill the deal. Before we go, I just want to apologize very quickly. I was chatting during a clip that was playing, and you know, we try to keep this show very PG-13, so I just want to apologize to anyone who was listening to my behind-the-scenes chatter.
So Stop the War Coalition is important because we have to prevent it becoming normal for there to be a constant war. Very soon, within the next few years, it will become the normal for there to be a constant war in the West. People will reach maturity and adulthood under the understanding that there is always a war. And at that point, war will not be something that is unusual or surprising or horrifying. War will become the new normal.
With the work of Mr. Assange.
I do.
Happen to a nicer guy, is my view, but...
Well, look, he has to answer for what he has done, that he may be the only foreigner that this administration would welcome to the United States. Thank you very much.
Harry Dyer and Ronald Clinton.
That's my name. That's right.
You are a war criminal. The people of Libya.
So, I mean, that is the land of... unconfirmed.
Yes, we came, we saw, he died.
Did it have anything to do with your visit?
No, I'm sure it did.
Ground of power, of dignity, of freedom for Africa. Africa for Africans. The land of Africa is for Africans. Everywhere, our land is our land. Everything is our land. My friends, everywhere. You are strong now. You are marching to the glory for once, for the progress.
One governmental organization, Amnesty International, has delivered stinging criticism of the European Union and its handling of the migrant crisis, saying European governments are complicit in grave human rights violations in Libya through their support for authorities there that often work with people smugglers and torture refugees and migrants.
We are detailing the human rights violations that refugees and migrants in Libya are suffering. We're talking about arbitrary detention, torture, and...
We came, we saw, he died.
Did it have anything to do with your visit?
A few moments later...
What do you see as the biggest challenge for women, peace, and security over the next 10 years? What is the next milestone we are all aiming for?
Well, I think the biggest challenge is men starting wars, and I don't think they have enough to do.
It has a right to defend itself, but we also have to expect Israel to do everything.
Israel is not defending itself. It's a genocide that you're paying for. And then you talk about women's rights? Are you serious? What women's rights are you talking about?
You have been responsible for the killing of hundreds of Pakistanis. You have supported wars in Afghanistan, in Iraq, all over the Middle East. You are a war criminal.
Raise loss of life of Jewish people since the Holocaust.
And how dare you speak about human rights while Palestinians are being murdered? In the name of protections of human rights. It has nothing to do with human rights.
It's killing 30,000 civilians, acceptable self-hospitals, it's killing 10,000 children, acceptable self-defense.
The people of Iraq, the people of Syria, the people of Yemen,
okay.
You might be sitting around wondering why this crazy lady that is always promoting feminism can sit there and casually laugh about the death of Mr. Gaddafi. And Gaddafi was the last hope for Africa in order for us to establish our own currency, which now we've evolved and now we've become a part of BRICS nations. But the reason why she's able to laugh about it casually is because she doesn't value life. And She's been involved in so many different forms of regime change in the Middle East, and how she can laugh at these youth that are outraged and speaking is because her mentor was the founder of modern day activism, a Zionist by the name of Saul Alinsky.
Just fan the flames. Get them to be your little agitators. Get them to start organizing, and you may have to, I would say, from what little I know, and God, I know damn little at this point, but the older generation is absolutely hopeless in this picture. So I would work strictly with the kids and fan, agitate.
What is worth more?
Get, you know, get the fires burning and start getting little torches here and here and here and here and here. And then go with the action.
In the past, and you know, we think in terms of not so much what we can take, but so much as what we can give. And I think Indians can be organized around the amount that they can give to the white man, not so much around the amount that they can take from him. Because 400 years has already proven that the Indian isn't so inclined toward the white man's society. He hasn't come into it, and he refuses to. But to organize them around things that they can give the white man. And do you think yourself that
what do you mean you're going to organize around things you can give? What?
We can give them a way of life that is better than the one you got already.
We're not buying that. Forget that. That's being so idealistically unreal that you're out of the world on that.
But I see the hippies are buying it. And I see a whole portion of the youth constituency that are buying it. I hear things now love and...
This is a very minute segment.
It's minute now, but it's a start. It's like what you said about getting a little compromise. It's the start. And from that start, maybe something can happen.
Look. There are things you want. It comes down very simply. Do you want them? If you want them, you have to go out and get them. If you want to go out and get them, there are only certain ways that you go out and get them. If you want to sit around and talk about love, and you want to talk about Christianity, and Christians were talking about love, you know, there were hippies back then. There were more than hippies. They walked into the Colosseum with the lions and the tigers and everything else and died for it, you know, for love. And Father, forgive them, etc. If you want to do it that way, I mean, go ahead. As I told you before, this is the kind of thing that the white society would love to see you do, because they know you're not going anywhere. And it means that they can go on doing what they want without being concerned about making any changes.
They'd
love to see all the Negroes in America living on their reserves.
Well, you know, you seem like a man who has no love or none of these feelings or anything, isn't
it? I have a hell of a lot more love than you have, because I'm willing to go out and get corrupted for it. I'm willing to fight for it. I'm willing to stick my life on a line on it. And you're just willing to stick around and talk about love and hippies and not do a goddamn thing.
Yeah, but that's not true.
The hell it is. We wouldn't be talking about it this way.
What do you know about values that we say that are Indian, and those things that are entailed in this whole thing of things that belong to people, their own values, their own culture, and all those things that are built into their way of life, their environment, those things that they feel good about, they feel comfortable.
All I know is what I heard at the luncheon table today, but let me say this to you. I will assume that you have a wonderful set of values to feel comfortable with. My ancestors had a set of values called the Ten Commandments, which they thought that they would feel comfortable with. In the world as it is, the rest of the people in the world will only... let you have as much of your own values as you're strong enough to keep. And you can only get changes as you're strong enough to get them. And as you have the ability to act on it, it is impossible, believe me on this one thing, it is impossible to chart, regardless of what procedure you're using, to chart an orderly plan of organization. a very disorganized manner in the beginning. But actually, in the beginning, you use the opposition as your main organizer. You literally provoke them into actions against you that will irritate more people and get them moving.
I wouldn't bother to do anything.
You know what your young friend ought to do over there? He ought to organize all the Indian reserves into the hippie movement.
Well, maybe that's what all the Indian reserves want, if they all want that.
The Indian hippies coming out of Canada, this may be the answer.
Well, if that's what they want, it may very well be the answer. I mean, following your own statement, like these people sit down and they say, look, we all want to be hippies.
You'll get the biggest tourist trade and that'll solve your economic problem.
No, but I mean, look, you're making fun of it.
I'm not making fun. I'm being dead serious.
Saul Alinsky had a special tactic of targeting the youth, college-age youth, very specifically during the 1960s, and he used African-American youth to go out and protest, and it was the way of the Zionist movement being able to control civil rights to a certain degree because they helped establish the NAACP and all these different movements that Jewish people ended up controlling and subsidizing Africans and granting them some bit of control to keep them away from Islamic influence that was coming from Malcolm X.
First, you tell us that it is manly to keep your word. All right? If you are a man, you keep your word. And now all that the black people in this country are demanding, and even the black people in the whole world are demanding, is that you keep your word. You told us we were free. Well, then show us that we're free. You told us that there is justice, equality for all in this country. Well, then stick to your word and let us see the justice and equality for all. Or else admit to us that you're not a man. You're a worm. You're afraid of us. You're afraid to give us equal stand. You're afraid that if you give us equal ground, that we will match you and we will override you. And if that's what you're afraid of us, then tell us that just what you're afraid of. But don't keep hiding it from us and holding this up to us. And every time we ask you for something, you give us a little bit of something. And it's all tokenism. We don't want tokenism. And there are most black men in this world that don't want charity. And yet still every time we ask you for something, you give us a little piece, a little piece. You're playing games with us. We're not children. We're big men. I've seen my father have to put up with all kinds of stuff. He was a big man. He raised a family. He went down south and he had to go around to the back door with his wife. We're not asking for anything. We're not asking for any favors. All we want is what's ours.
Now, also Saul Alinsky, he had a special tactic of targeting the college-age youth, specifically girls, because girls care a lot for social inclusion. And he used the youth of colleges to go out and protest for change. Saul Alinsky got all of his methods during his time working underneath the Chicago mob through Al Capone. We covered a bit about Saul Alinsky in our Balenciaga episode, which is on Rumble because YouTube apparently could not handle the amount of information we were divulging and sharing with you guys. So you can learn about Saul Alinsky there, but he is a guy who openly prays at Satan as one of his greatest influences and inspirations and as a noble leader for the world. And so this is Hillary Clinton's mentor. So you can see why evil can smile about evil and just have no conscience about what she's doing. Today, Western governments want you to think immigration is the issue, but it's absolutely not, because in countries such as Dubai, immigration exists and it flows very smoothly in a very multi-ethnic city. But that's because the rule of law is very strict.
Dubai is one of the most multicultural and multi-ethnic cities in the entire world.
Mm-hmm.
It's also one of the safest cities in the entire world. It's also one of the cleanest cities in the entire world. The crime rate is as close to zero as you're going to get. And this is a city of 3 million people. It's not some tiny place.
Yeah.
People are just there with their families, they're working and so on. So when I see a lot of American, British, European, and so on commentators, especially more on the conservative right-wing side, a thing I hear a lot is that multiculturalism doesn't work. Multiculturalism has failed. And I know what people mean when they say that, but I don't think they've actually quite diagnosed it correctly. I don't think it's the having a lot of people of different cultures, let alone ethnicities, racial groups or whatever, mm-hmm. together in one place that is the problem, which is most people stop there. They're like, oop, that's it. It doesn't work.
Yeah.
Right. I think the problem is the place they're in, not knowing what the boundaries and rules of law, respect, tolerance, human dignity, and so on are and should be. So when I'm in a place like Dubai, you could say Abu Dhabi, you could say Doha, yeah. the reason why it works is because the rule of law is very strong. As long as you are not hurting, robbing, stealing, stabbing, shooting, you're not hurting anyone.
Yeah.
You're not taking anybody's stuff. You're not being disrespectful, shouting and screaming at people in public. I don't know, getting naked in public, doing any of this weird, crazy stuff that for whatever reason in the UK sometimes, certainly in the US, like people kind of just like tolerate and shrug and they're like, oh yeah, well, that guy's shoplifting. Okay, whatever, right? Like
yeah.
they don't tolerate that. So there are some very hard lines. And then within that, it's like, cool, you can practice your faith. You can go to church, you can go to mosque, you can go to synagogue. When I was there, I saw like a Jewish guy with like the sit and the kippah and full on everything, just like, you know, walking around the city. And I was like, that's actually really interesting. Next, you know, walking past guys who are wearing thobes and kefiahs. Yeah. And then there's another, you know, Russian family there and they've got their like Orthodox crosses. And actually no one bothers anyone. No one has beef mm-hmm. with anyone. People just get on. So it's actually very multicultural and even multi-religious, despite the fact it's in an Islamic country, but it just works because people agree on those things. And it seems like what's happening here is you're not having the assimilation and the respect of the local culture, and you're not having the respect and enforcement of like the ground rules.
Hey guys, if you want to watch more clips, click here.
And if you want to watch the full podcast, click right here.